right. It's 2:45. I just passed the Sunset Falls campground. I'm headed up to the area where the witnesses had their encounter. Hang on, I need to adjust this camera. Better. I've got the GoPro and the contour running, and I've got my other cameras on standby. Four tenths of a mile from where the road turns off, it's this general area, although they said there was a dead end road. Tenths of a mile from where 4205 turns off. Here it is.
Arriving at NF4205 and NF42.
All right, I'm gonna go up this road.
December 16th, 2012, 2:06 p.m. John and I are in the area where the two brothers reported to be surrounded by Sasquatch. We're about 1,500 feet. This is a little side trail that they turned down about 2 in the morning and realized they really couldn't go much further without maybe getting stuck in the mud, so they stopped, and that's where they were approached and surrounded off this main forest road. So we're gonna walk around and look for tree breaks or anything like that. And they eventually had backed out back onto the road here and saw the two creatures crossing the road right about as far as you can see where that road bends to the right is where the crossing occurred. Two creatures crossed. There's John walking up and looking for evidence. So the infrasound incident and the footsteps and everything from the creatures they heard was right down here, and they end up backing up and had the visuals. And they also claimed to have seen a dark figure in a tree. I can't remember, I believe it was right up here at one point. So we're gonna look around for a while and see what we can see.
I remember I was telling the researcher, or the quote unquote researchers.
Not too long ago. How long ago was it, Wes, when you and I went back up there and we saw the helicopter up there and there's the military was involved? How long ago was that? A couple months ago or something like that?
Yeah, probably 2 months.
Yeah, it was probably 2 months ago. So when Wes and I had our encounter, you know, we've been back several times. We've, you know, checking things out and whatnot. But we went back about it was a year ago this month that, you know, we actually had our encounter. And we went back about 2 months ago. And Wes has actually been back there more recent than I have. But the military is also involved in the area where we actually had our encounter. And when Wes and I went up there one night, there was a trailer parked up there. And I've talked about this on the show before, and I think I told Will about it too. There was a trailer up there with a helicopter. They had several, we went driving by, and they had several TVs, cameras set up inside. You could see inside this big, huge trailer thing they had up there. They had a water truck up there. And then they had a camera pointing straight up in there. It was like a 360-degree camera. You know, they were doing several, they were filming a bunch of stuff, and they kind of shoot us along. We had said a few things to them, and we got the feeling like we're unwelcome.
Yeah, I know I've mentioned it before, but where the woman disappeared, Wendy and I went up into the area. Everything looked staged. We go up to this area, and there's trucks that are labeled funny. They don't look like they've spent a day in their life out actually in construction, like water truck. Trailers that had television screens inside of them, and then had a huge mounted antenna with what looked like a thermal camera that was probably, if I were to guess, I'd say a $500,000 camera. this camera sitting up there, and the lady, you know, basically said they were the logging company, which I've never seen a logging company with a huge camera in the air, and we were chased off the mountain.
Okay, what you just saw was a 41-page report that went over the details regarding Wes and Woody's encounter. It's a report that compiles weather conditions, moon phases, GPS coordinates, other Bigfoot groups that had interactions with Wes during this time. Now, there is, for one of the first things, there is some debate about the actual date when this occurred. Wes and Woody was trying to say that it was a completely different date, and they even called a local Bigfoot group that they gave their report to originally liars, which prompted that group to release the emails and everything regarding their contact with Wes and Woody. And the email shows that Wes emailed this Bigfoot group, WASRT, on November 16th, 2012, to tell them about him and his brother's encounter with three Sasquatches. It's not really up for debate when this actual encounter occurred. It's locked in. Now, there is some speculation if it was the actual 15th or 16th. The general consensus is that it was actually November 15th when this occurred. The other dispute was the location. Now, they gave a mountain location where they said they had their encounter, but on episode 87, when they were addressing a lot of the concerns that people had, they gave GPS coordinates to an entirely different mountain called Jack Mountain, which is about 10 miles away. So that there is kind of suspect on why, you know, they would do something like that, maybe to troll people, I guess. I'm not sure. One of the big things to dispute their report is the moon phase, the moon itself. If you read or listen to Wes and Woody's original encounter, the moon played a huge part in the actual encounter itself. As far as it lighting up the sky, they were able to see it in the rearview mirror, and it was one of the reasons why they were able to see outside of their car to see all this movement going on. But unfortunately, on the 15th and 16th, there was no moon visible. There was no moonlight actually visible on that day because the moon was so far below the horizon. So it'd be pretty much near darkness. So the moon was not a factor with creating the light that they were saying that they saw that night. So what they ended up saying was that it ended up being solar flares that caused the light that they saw, in the rearview mirror. Solar flares is essentially aurora borealis. And so they're saying that that's what created all the ambient light to create it all. They even have a message of a article that they have on their forum that talks about how a solar flare on those 2 days was intense. But if you continue to read the article, further down the article, it says that the solar flares were not pointed at Earth and will have little to no impact on Earth itself. So the solar flare option is off the table as well, because it would not have produced the light necessary to see these creatures roaming around, let alone to mistaking it for the moon light. So that doesn't seem like it's a very good option for the light source. One of the other big ones is the weather. Now, if you again read and listen to their original report, they talk about how it was clear. They were able to see stars, and that just wasn't the case on that day. It was a cloudy, foggy day on the 15th during their encounter. It was actually so, the visibility was so low, you couldn't even see a quarter mile down the road. So that there will call into question about the environmental conditions they were talking about experiencing during this encounter. On the 15th, on the 16th, the weather was also cloudy. So again, that would not produce the moon-filled, cloudless night filled with stars that they talked about having that night. So that's a very big red flag right there when the environmental conditions are not even the same. Again, so they tried to throw a local Bigfoot group, WASRT, underneath the bus as far as saying that they didn't do a quality investigation, that they were misleading people. And again, they came out with all the information and released a few videos, which we just recently watched as well. That Bigfoot group actually went out to Wes and Woody's location where they said they had the encounter 2 days after the email. And they were also there on about a month later in December and again a few weeks following the encounter. And you know, Wes and Woody talked about having a government presence there. And as you'll see in that video, there was no government presence. There was just a logging operation. So that their statements about the government interference or having some sort of part in it doesn't seem like it ever happened, according to the investigation to this Bigfoot group that went out there shortly after they had their encounter. Wes and Woody also talks about sending an email to Fish and Game, Wildlife Fish and Game, to tell them about their encounter. And the person who made this report actually contacted the Wildlife Fish and Game, and they did not receive a single email from Wes and Woody regarding their Bigfoot encounter. So that did not happen. You'll also see in the report that Wes and Woody doesn't actually own Sasquatch Chronicles. It's owned by an entertainment entity out of Texas. And you know, it seems like he is the financial backer of it, which is a bit odd for a podcast, Bigfoot podcast, but you know, that's who legally owns Sasquatch Chronicles. It's not even Wes or Woody. It's an individual down there in Texas, which, you know, that upon itself is, you know, it's not that unusual, but it is kind of weird that they would have a financial backer for this podcast there. And you know, in final in the report, you saw why Will Jevning and Shannon LeGros left the show. It was because of all the information coming out that was conflicting with what Wes and Woody was saying about their encounter. So Will Jevning and Shannon LeGros left the show at this exact same time. So this was the reason why they left. They talked about their own integrity and that they didn't want to get associated with hoaxers because they had their own reputation to protect, and they just didn't want to associate with the hoaxers, which is totally understandable. I too would distance myself from it. Now, what does this mean? You know, should you stop listening to Sasquatch Chronicles? Should you just leave the Bigfoot subject? All that stuff. I'm not saying any of that. This is information that should be widely known, that Wes and Woody lied about their original encounter to start a Bigfoot entertainment podcast. It's a podcast that I would not really go to for viable information. He has had some people on there that are legitimate people, that are truthful and honest. But when you have a podcast like that and you got to do it every week, it's going to be hard to find new people to come and tell their story. And if you go on Reddit, you'll actually see people talking about how they've identified certain people as repeat guests, but they're just playing a different character with a different story. So it seems like Wes is hiring people to come on and tell these encounter stories, you know, about what they're experiencing. And usually they're all pretty aggressive as far as what the Bigfoot is actually doing. And that's the whole thing with Wes and Woody about their encounters. They talk about how aggressive it was, and throughout their history in the subject, they talk about how aggressive they were, about how mean and fearful we should be of them. And that just seems like it's a false narrative in order to create a good platform for a Bigfoot podcast, something to kind of monetize, which they've done. And it's just kind of what it is with it. But the point of this video and releasing of this report is it's information that we should know about, especially if we are a paid subscriber to Sasquatch Chronicles, or we go to Sasquatch Chronicles looking for viable information for our own investigation into the subject. So that's pretty much the whole point of the video. Has nothing to do with jealousy, has nothing to do with trying to take down Sasquatch Chronicles. I know that's never going to happen. It's an impossible task. I don't even care that it's up and going. I mean, more power to them. But as long as people know and the information's out there that they lied to everybody about their original encounter, it did not happen like they said it would. And I did ask Wes Germer to, if he wanted to come and talk to me about it, and so we can maybe just hash this out and kind of go over it, if there's any sort of mistakes in the report or anything like that. But I haven't heard back from him yet, so I will keep that door open for him. I did actually double check all the facts in the report, and they are all accurate. So that report is 100% solid. And you know, I know that Wes and Sasquatch Chronicles is a really liked podcast in person. So I understand people, when they hear this, they're either not going to accept it or put that anger towards me and, you know, start trolling me and all that stuff. And I get it. You know, sometimes when we learn facts about this, we don't really know how to go about it. We don't know who to blame. We don't know where to put that negative energy that we've collected with learning this stuff. And, you know, with the people that are going to come and attack and put all threats and stuff like that, you know, it's fine. Just go and put it in the comments section, and, you know, it's not going to bother me at all. It's one of those things where I understand, you know, what you're kind of going through. And so I'm just going to kind of give you some time to fully process it, and hopefully you'll come back and be like, hey, yeah, you know, sorry I said all that stuff, but, you know, after really looking at the report from a non-biased perspective, I see that their encounter never happened. And if you're having a hard time trying to look at the report from a non-biased perspective, I recommend you bring in somebody, a non-Bigfooter, like a friend of yours that has nothing to do with the Bigfoot subject, so they will have no bias. And you can kind of go over it with them and kind of get their input on it, so you can get a different set of eyes looking on it, so you can get a better perspective of what you're looking at. So that's something I definitely recommend, because this report's pretty solid. It would stand up in court, actually, that their encounter never happened. I mean, you have at least 9 red flags. That's 9. Like, I call into question with 1 red flag. You know, even then it'll be like, okay, we'll see what you got. But we're talking about 9. I mean, they straight up lied to everybody. And when they got caught, they lied even more and try to cover it up. And that's why you won't really find a lot of their older stuff when they were talking about their encounter and stuff. especially from their blog spot days or whatever, won't find that stuff because they went to try and hide all that stuff so it wasn't used against them later on. So, again, you know, keep watching Sasquatch Chronicles if you want. Just know that it's a fiction show. I mean, I would probably, most all those encounters that you hear, probably not even real. Most of them are probably the same person. So as long as everybody knows that, you know, that's all I'm kind of interested in, is just making sure all the facts are out there, and so we can all make our own conclusions of what's kind of going on in the subject. So I guess that's it, and I'll talk to you guys later.